Dear students, after studying this module, you shall be able to know about the oxidation of alkenes with peroxy acids. You shall be able to learn how to bring enantioselectivity in the epoxidation of alkenes and identify the substrate that can undergo sharpless asymmetric epoxidation. We will be going into the in-depth study of sharpless asymmetric epoxidation in this module. And after we do that, you shall be able to evaluate the reaction conditions, the type of catalyst or reagents which are used for a successful asymmetric epoxidation. And you will be able to familiarize yourself with the application of sharpless epoxidation. So let us begin with knowing what are the reactions of alkenes with peroxy acids. And before we proceed with a detailed discussion of sharpless asymmetric epoxidation, which is used for the asymmetric epoxidation, it is imperative to have a little background knowledge about the reaction of alkenes with a peroxy acid. An alkene is oxidized to an epoxide by a peroxy acid. This you are already aware, but let us go into some more detail. The overall reaction amounts to the transfer of the extra oxygen atom from the peroxy acid to the alkene. The actual mechanism is not totally agreed upon, but is thought to involve a concerted process, as you can see here. So you can see in this figure that the alkene, when it is reacted with the peracid, that is RCOOOH, then it is this particular oxygen which gets transferred and gets attached to the double bond in the form of epoxide, and in turn there is, you can see, there is a cyclic rearrangement which happens, and it is a concerted simultaneous process happening, and there is a byproduct of RCOOH. Notice in the byproduct here, the initially single bond has converted to double bond, and the initial double bond O, the C double bond O of carboxylic acid, has eventually come out as the singly bonded OH. So this is all because of this concerted mechanism which is happening. Now, due to the reaction being a concerted process, the bonds cannot rotate. So there is no opportunity for the relative positions of the groups bonded to the carbons of the alkene to change. Therefore, a cis alkene will form a cis epoxide, whereas a trans alkene will form a trans epoxide. That is, it means the reaction is syn-stereospecific. And as you can see in these examples shown, starting with this particular cis alkene, where the two hydrogens are on the same side and the two alkyls are on the other end, relatively on the same side, and when reacted with this peracid, the RCOOH, then we get this epoxide where the stereochemistry is syn. That is, from a cis alkene, you are getting this cis epoxide. On the other hand, when you start from this trans alkene and treat it with the peracid, then again the epoxide is formed from the same side without any change in the stereochemistry, and what you get is the trans epoxide from trans alkene. But notice that in this case, there will be these two isomers formed, where the epoxide can be attacking from one side of the molecule or from the other side. In the cis, both of these would have been superimposable. So here you are getting these enantiomeric mixture. After this, let us move towards the sharpless asymmetric epoxidation. The oxidation of alkenes to epoxide by the use of alkyl hydroperoxide was also found to be catalyzed by a transition metal, for example vanadium. The proposed mechanism for this reaction indicates the coordination of the alkene to an empty coordination site on the metal, which positions the alkene to attack the electrophilic peroxide. And this is depicted in this figure. You can see here that this vanadium transition metal is catalyzing this addition, and on the alkene you are getting this epoxide formation. So the oxygen eventually is getting transferred from the per acid to this particular CC double bond of alkene. Further, it was shown that allylic alcohols could be used to impart facial selectivity, that is to yield epoxy alcohols with the OH group on the same side as the epoxy group, which is attributed to the coordination of the OH group with the transition metal. So, let us look at this particular equation here, where we have this cyclohexenol, where the molecule has double bond as well as OH, which is on one side of this cyclohexene ring. And when this is subjected to epoxidation, you can see the epoxide which is formed on the same side of the OH is 98%, and where the epoxide is formed on the other side of the OH is only 2%. That is, you can clearly see that how the allyl, in case of allyl alcohol, the facial selectivity is there and the OH in a way is helping the attack or the formation of epoxide on the same side as its presence. Furthermore, Professor Sharpless extended this work, and he was successful in transforming the dist�ומריק epoxide formation from the allyl alcohols to an enantioselective process by using a chiral ligand with a transition metal catalyst. Here he used an oxidizing agent, that is hydroperoxide, and most commonly even the tertiary butyl hydroperoxide can be used. The catalyst used is the isopropyloxy titanium, and the chiral ligand used is enantiomeric, or better, the enantiopure dialkyl tartrate. Commonly we can say it is either plus diethyl tartrate or it is minus diethyl tartrate. So using these, he could get the epoxide formation in a highly enantioselective manner. And as you can clearly see in this particular equation shown here, that starting from this allyl alcohol, if the tertiary butyl hydroperoxide is used and you use this titanium catalyst, and if the plus diethyl tartrate is used, then the epoxide is formed on the opposite side of the OH. On the other hand, if the same conditions are used but in place of plus diethyl tartrate we use the minus diethyl tartrate, then in that case the epoxide ring is formed on the same side of that of the OH. That is, using the plus and the minus diethyl tartrate as the chiral ligands in their enantiopure forms, we are able to get the enantiomeric epoxides, and this is what is the Sharpless epoxidation. And what you can see is shown here are the enantiomeric diethyl tartrates. You can clearly see out of these two, this is the plus RR diethyl tartrate, and this one is the minus SS diethyl tartrate. The most significant part of Sharpless asymmetric epoxidation is that just by the use of tartrate ligand of opposite optical purity, the resultant epoxide product is also of opposite stereochemistry with almost greater than 90% enantiomeric excess. Now, this asymmetric epoxidation is one of the most reliable, selective and practical method for conversion of allylic alcohols to enantiomeric epoxides, which can be subsequently converted into a host of other chiral molecules. This reaction was developed in 1980s and was so successful and found many applications, which subsequently resulted in the Nobel Prize for Professor Sharpless in 2001 along with the other contributors. Let us now move to the mechanistic aspects of Sharpless epoxidation. Now, if we try to look at the detailed mechanism, as discussed, we are already familiar that there are four main elements which are required for understanding the sharpless epoxidation mechanism, and they are the allyl alcohol, tertiary butyl hydroperoxide, the transition metal catalyst, and the chiral ligand, that is dialkyl tartrate, which we will have to consider. Now, initially the reaction involved use of stoichiometric amounts of the titanium catalyst, but use of molecular sieves improved the scope of reaction, requiring only 5 to 10% mole percentage of the titanium 4 catalyst. However, no reaction takes place in the absence of titanium catalyst. When this titanium catalyst is added, so that the oxidizing agent, the chiral ligand, and the substrate can assemble to form an enantiomeric pure chiral complex. The actual mechanism is not known, but DFT and kinetic studies along with experimental results have led to a most plausible mechanism for this reaction, as we can see in this figure. And what you can notice here is the coordination of the tartrate ligand to the titanium catalyst occurs with the displacement of two isopropoxide ligands, and this is attributed to the higher binding constant of the bidentate tartrate ligand. Or you can say the next step is the tertiary butyl peroxide then displaces one more isopropoxide, followed by another isopropoxide displacement by the allyl alcohol to coordinate with the metal. And after this, the titanium complex is active catalyst species and is believed to exist as a dimer. And it has many features conducive for the successful epoxidation to occur. That is, the instead of a planar arrangement, the peroxide titanium interaction has a spiro arrangement in the transition state for the oxygen transfer. Another thing to notice is the OO bond of peroxide is approximately perpendicular to the plane of alkene bond, facilitating the latter's attack. The steric effect of the bulky peroxide and the chiral tartrate ligand lead to such a conformation of the transition state that blocks one side of the attack of alkene and plays an important role in deciding the enantioselectivity of the reaction. And the next step is, that is the oxidation of olefin with this tertiary butyl hydroperoxide then occurs. The alkene acts as a nucleophile to attack the equatorial oxygen atoms of the peroxide, and studies have shown that the dimeric complex has ester groups of the tartrate in axial position, which blocks one mode of approach. Thus, the chiral diethyl tartrate dictates the phase of attack and leads to a stereoselective epoxide alcohol. And all this you can clearly see in this mechanism of sharpless epoxidation. Now, after understanding this mechanism, let us see how to predict the chirality of the epoxide product. Now, each enantiomer of the tartrate ligand delivers the epoxide oxygen atom to one face of the double bond regardless of the substitution pattern, and this can be predicted by using a manomic. Draw the allyl alcohol with the double bond vertically and hydroxymethyl group at the lower hand side. A rectangle is drawn around the double bond in the same plane as the carbons of the double bond, as you can see here, with the other substituents in their appropriate corners. In this orientation, the minus diester tartrate preferentially interacts with the top half of the molecule, and the plus diester tartrate preferentially interacts with the bottom half of the molecule. Thus, minus diethyl tartrate, or the diester tartrate in general, results in epoxide which are above the plane, and plus diethyl tartrate results in epoxide below the plane. And as an application of this, let us look at this particular example where we start with this simple allyl alcohol and when it is reacted with or subjected to sharpless epoxidation in the presence of minus diethyl tartrate, then we are getting the epoxide above the plane. On the other hand, if we do this reaction in the presence of the plus diethyl tartrate, then we are getting the epoxide ring below the plane. So here the allyl alcohol is drawn such that the CC double bond is vertical and a rectangle is drawn around this particular plane. So the above and below plane that we are talking is around this particular rectangle as a plane which we have formed. So the essential condition is just place the CC double bond as vertical on this rectangular plane, and then if it is minus diethyl tartrate you are using, it will be resulting above the plane, and plus diethyl tartrate will result in epoxide below the plane. Moving to the substrate scope, sharpless asymmetric epoxidations cannot be carried out on all olefins but on almost all primary or secondary allyl alcohols. The allylic hydroxyl group serves to coordinate the reactant to titanium, while primary allyl alcohols are reacted to completion. Secondary allyl alcohols usually give around 50% conversion. The reaction is highly chemoselective and converts only allyl alcohol to the epoxide, as you can see from this particular example shown here. Here you can see that the double bond which is allylic to this particular OH is undergoing epoxidation. The E allylic alcohols or unhindered Z allylic alcohols act as excellent substrates. E substituted olefins have faster reaction rate than the Z substituted ones, with Z substituted olefins being the least reactive and selective. Another thing to notice here is the chiral substrate will yield two diastereomers, but the sharpless asymmetric epoxidation method overrides any substrate control and results in the predicted product, although in some cases the enantiomeric axis may vary. For example, as shown in this equation, the acetonide protected diol is giving two diastereomers. You can notice that here these are the two diastereomers. But when this is performed without catalyst, the diastereomeric ratio is 2.3:1, while with use of minus DIPT, a diastereomeric ratio of 90:1 is obtained. On the other hand, plus DIPT leads to the diastereomeric ratio of 1:22. Chiral allylic alcohols, particularly the secondary alcohols, react with different rates with two enantiomers of the chiral ligand, and this can be explained on the basis of the previously explained model, wherein the substituents may block the approach of the metal bound peroxide to the preferred geometry with the alkene, and this can be understood from this visual. Shown here are the two chiral allylic alcohols. So first of all, what you have to do is you write them as discussed right now, somewhat earlier, that you make a rectangle and place these allyl alcohols with the CC double bond vertically positioned. And you can see here that these two are chiral alcohols. Notice that the R and H are interchanged to have the chirality. Now, in these two respective chiral allylic alcohols, if we look for the attack, if the minus tartrate is attacking from the top for epoxidation, this is slow. On the other hand, if L plus tartrate attacks from the lower side, it is fast. Similarly, in its enantiomeric alcohol, which is this right side of this molecule, you can see here that on this particular double bond, if the D minus tartrate help is taken, then the epoxidation is fast from the top, and if L plus tartrate is taken, then the epoxidation from the lower side is slow. Another thing we can notice that in this following example, as the equation is shown here, the S enantiomer reacts almost 100 times faster than the R isomer with the use of plus DIPT and can yield up to 96% optical pure epoxide from below the plane. In the R isomer case, the reaction with plus DIPT is slow and also less enantioselective. Now, this feature can be used for kinetic resolution of racemic secondary allylic alcohols. Kinetic resolution is defined as a process in which one of the enantiomer constituent of a racemic mixture is more readily transformed into a product than is the other. Thus, in Sharpless method, fine tuning the reaction conditions and by proper choice of the chiral tartrate ligand, one cannot only enantio enrich the less reactive isomer but can get a more optical pure epoxide product as it is described or illustrated by this particular example. So, you can notice in this particular substituted allyl alcohol when you are using the plus DIPT, then this particular one is 49% yield and there is 99% enantiomeric excess. And what you get here is the other one, which is 48% yield and there is 99% enantiomeric excess. So, you can clearly see in this equation or the reaction shown here, when you are taking this substituted allyl alcohol and you are subjecting it to plus DIPT in the Sharpless epoxidation, we are getting these two in corresponding almost 99% enantiomeric excess. Presence of other chiral alcohols or functional groups in other parts of the molecule do not have an effect in enantio and chemoselectivity in this reaction. Moving further, another thing you should note is the tertiary allylic alcohols do not give good yields due to steric bulk of the substituents, but when use of the zirconium catalyst, that is the zirconium isopropoxide is done, it was found to enhance the reactivity towards Sharpless epoxidation owing to the longer zirconium oxygen bond, which facilitates the formation of active complex between the metal and tertiary allyl alcohol. Now, after this, let us study the improvements which have been done to the Sharpless methodology, and significant of them is first is the use of molecular sieves. The reaction is water sensitive as water can destroy the active catalytic species and also may lead to opening of the formed epoxide. Hence, earlier procedures involved use of stoichiometric reagents, but use of molecular sieves has greatly solved this problem. Molecular sieves of pore size 3 to 4 angstrom are used, which lead to a dramatic decrease in the requirement of the catalyst, that is even less than 10% catalyst is required, and also the use of chiral tartrate has dropped down almost less than 13%. Besides the economic advantage, this often leads to milder conditions, ease of isolation and increased yields. Another thing is use of or the modification is the use of supported catalyst. Owing to many advantages associated with the heterogeneous catalysts like the ease of use, the recyclability, ease of workup, etc., many approaches have been developed to prepare heterogeneous Sharpless type catalyst systems for the asymmetric epoxidation of allylic alcohols. Either the titanium catalyst was made heterogeneous or the chiral ligands were mounted on the polymer support such as polystyrene. However, polymer based supported catalysts usually swelled in the reaction mixture, aggravating the workup procedures. Then PEG mounted tartrates were also used, but although they did simplify the purification procedure and recyclability, the enantiomeric excess was much lower as compared to the conventional procedure and decreased further on recycling. And you can see here, as shown in these structures, these are the structures shown for the PEG supported tartrates. That is how you can support the tartrate on PEGs. And you have also depicted here is the titanium catalyst supported on mesoporous silica, that is MCM41. Furthermore, inorganic organic hybrid titanium complex such as MCM41 silica supported catalyst was developed, which showed improved enantiomeric excess up to almost 84%, and the products could be simply isolated via filtration and evaporation of the solvent. And the structure of the titanium catalyst supported on mesoporous silica MCM41 is as shown here. Next thing is, or next modification is, the use of higher temperature. The conventional sharpless conditions required lower temperature, that is -78 to -20 degrees, to be maintained, which is a costly affair. Hence, development of catalyst systems which may override the use of lower temperature is another field of improvement in this reaction. A titanocene tartrate catalyst was developed which has given good yields at even room temperature and which is comparatively quite higher than -78 degrees to -20 degrees centigrade range. However, the enantio selectivity were not so high. The reagent was generated before the reaction and then used. As you can see here, this is how this titanocene tartrate catalyst can be prepared by the combination of this titanium metallocene. You can see this is the cyclopentadienyl anion with two chlorine ligands, and by reacting it with this dimethyl tartrate in the presence of trimethyl amine. So this has proved to be effective, that rather than very low temperature conditions, the reaction can be done at comparatively higher temperature, that is room temperature. Now, after all this, let us try to know where are the applications of the sharpless asymmetric epoxidation. Sharpless asymmetric epoxidation has been widely used by researchers and in industry for the synthesis of chiral cores of various natural products and pharmaceutically active agents. Not only it involves inexpensive reagents, the predictions of the stereochemistry of the product are always spot on. Also, the resulting epoxide can be converted to chiral diols, amino alcohols, ethers, etc. And hence, this method is quite easy and efficient for asymmetric induction. Many different types of natural products like carbohydrates, terpenes, antibiotics, etc. have been synthesized using this reaction. Also, the OH group of the resulting epoxide can be converted to a leaving group such as mesyl, tosyl, etc., which can be easily substituted by the nucleophilic attack of other moieties, as you have already studied earlier. And for example, we can consider this case. You can see here the synthesis of naphthalene product was completed by the conversion of the optically pure epoxy alcohol from the sharpless method to its mesyl derivative and subsequent substitution by the naphtho quinol. So here you can see that the first step, you are doing the epoxidation, and then there is a mesyl chloride that you are using for mesylating this OH, and then furthermore you are having this naphthol, and then the OMS is being replaced with this particular O naphthyl derivative. And later on, this TMS can be removed, you get this epoxide, and furthermore you can replace and you can ring open this epoxide, add the IPR NH2 and get this required molecule. The sex pheromone of the gypsy moth, the plus dispatcher was synthesized in good and ensure purity by using sharpless epoxidation followed by Wittig reaction and selective hydrogenation as it is depicted in this equation. So you can see that here again we are starting from this allyl alcohol, we are getting this epoxide, and further with PCC the OH is getting oxidized into, this is the primary alcohol getting oxidized into this aldehyde, and furthermore with this Wittig reaction we are introducing this particular alkyl as the with a double bond the in place of this carbonyl, and later on with selective hydrogenation this double bond gets reduced into single bond, and it is how this pheromone of gypsy moth in these steps can be prepared in the lab. Similarly, sharpless epoxidation has been applied for the synthesis of a antibacterial agent as shown here, and you can again see here starting from this substituted allyl alcohol, the first step is this sharpless epoxidation where this double bond is getting converted into epoxide, and later on we are having this cyclization and then we are getting this antibacterial agent. So there are numerous such examples, and sharpless asymmetric epoxidation can be considered as one of the most successful methods for asymmetric induction in chiral substrates. So dear students, I hope you have understood in detail the sharpless epoxidation, and let us summarize what we have learned here. Sharpless epoxidation is an enantioselective method to prepare 2-3 epoxy alcohols from primary and secondary allyl alcohols. We also studied that it involves the use of tertiary butyl hydroperoxide as the oxidant, titanium isopropoxide as the catalyst, and chiral alkyl tartrate as a ligand in solvents like dichloromethane at low temperature conditions from around -78°C to -20°C. It is highly chemoselective as only allyl alcohols are converted to the corresponding epoxides. The beauty of sharpless epoxidation is the high degree of enantioselectivity it shows just by the use of different enantiomer of the chiral tartrate, and which is largely unaffected by other chiral centers present in the substrate. The active catalytic species exists as a dimer and is formed by ligand exchange of the titanium catalyst with one molecule each of the tartrate as a bidentate ligand. The tertiary butyl hydroperoxide and the allyl alcohol resulting in such a conformation of the transition state that blocks one side of the attack of the alkene to the OO bond of peroxide and plays an important role in deciding the enantioselectivity of the reaction. We also studied the various modifications to the original procedure have resulted in higher convergence and drastic decrease in the amount of catalyst and chiral ligand. These include use of molecular sieves, supported catalysts, and use of catalysts working at higher temperatures. The reaction has found numerous applications in the synthesis of natural products and pharmaceutically active molecules. And we also studied that the epoxide formed as a result of sharpless epoxidation can be converted to various other products like chiral diols, amino alcohols, ethers, etc., and can be used to generate a plethora of important chiral derivatives. Thank you.